Ladies and gentlemen, if you can take your seats, please. Welcome back to the session, the panel discussion, Advancing Global Green Chemistry, the Role of Government, Industry and Academia. It is now my great privilege and pleasure to introduce Madeleine Jacobs, who will moderate the panel discussion, and she will introduce the panelists and explain the ground rules to you. Madeleine Jacobs has been Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer of the American Chemical Society since 2004. Prior to that, she was Editor-in-Chief of Chemical Engineering News, before that, she was Chief Science Writer at the Smithsonian Institute. She graduated in chemistry from George Washington University and received an honorary Doctor of Science degree from the same university in 2003. And she's currently a member of the George Washington University Board of Trustees. Madeleine has devoted much of her professional career to promoting science and technology careers to young women and minorities, and to communicating science to a broad audience. She has had a significant impact on the public perception of science through her writing and lectures on communication of science at the national and international level. And she is the recipient of numerous awards for her writing and other activities. I can mention a few: the New York Academy of Sciences Women's History Month Award, the American Chemical Society Award for encouraging women into careers in the chemical sciences, and the National Organization for the Professional Advancement of Black Chemists and Chemical Engineers President's Award. So it is now my great privilege to invite Madeleine to take the floor as the moderator of this panel discussion. Madeleine.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Roger, and it's wonderful to be here and to have this great privilege. I want to, first of all, ask those who are here in the audience to be sure your cell phone is turned off. We are streaming live around the world, and we just don't want to have any, you know, beeps that confuse our international audience. So good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you are in the world. And welcome to this special session of the 16th Annual Green Chemistry and Engineering Conference. We are in Washington, D.C. with a live audience, and as I said, we are streaming around the world. On behalf of the American Chemical Society and the ACS Green Chemistry Institute, we are very proud to bring you this panel session on Advancing Global Green Chemistry, the Role of Government, Business, and Academia. This event allows the ACS Green Chemistry Institute to utilize state-of-the-art technology to further enhance the profile and importance of green chemistry for a global audience. We are bringing you world-renowned speakers who are going to share their thoughts and answer your questions. I think we all believe, just because we're here, that green chemistry and engineering hold the key to a sustainable future, and they're going to play a vital role in reinvigorating the global economy. If we are to make true progress in advancing green chemistry and building a sustainable planet, we need to have all the interested parties involved in the discussion. Before I provide an overview of how today's hybrid meeting will work, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce the panelists for today's meeting. And the panelists are, and I'll give a very brief introduction as I introduce each one. Dr. Cheryl Martin is Deputy Director for Commercialization, Advanced Research Projects Agency, Energy, also known as ARPA-E. Dr. Martin prior to this position, Dr. Martin was an executive in residence with Kleiner, Perkins, Caulfield, and Byers, a venture capital firm based in Menlo Park, California. But I first met Cheryl when she was at Roman Haas. She was an executive there for 20 years as a senior scientist and ran a number of global businesses, was also director of financial planning. She's had a really extraordinary career. She has a BA degree in chemistry from the College of Holy Cross and a PhD in organic chemistry from MIT. She's very active in the American Chemical Society and national levels, and also serves on the board of directors for Philabundance, the Greater Philadelphia region's largest hunger relief organization. Mr. Adam Monroe, who is the North American president for Novozymes. And Mr. Monroe has been president of Novozymes North America, Inc., an affiliate of Novozymes AS since August 2009. He served as director of supply chain operations in the Americas for the Danish company. He joined Novozymes in 1991, and he serves as director of biotechnology industry organization. Mr. Monroe received his bachelor's degree in chemical engineering from the University of Arkansas. And Dr. Matthew Platz, who is director for the Division of Chemistry at the National Science Foundation. Dr. Platz joined The Ohio State University in 1978 and became chair of the chemistry department. He received numerous awards, including being elected Melvin S. Newman Professor of Chemistry and appointed Distinguished University Professor. He's an Alfred P. Sloan Fellow, a Camille and Henry J. Dreyfus Teacher Scholar, and he has received the Distinguished Scholar Award and the College of the Arts and Sciences Teaching Award of The Ohio State University. From the American Chemical Society, he received the prestigious Cope Scholar Award and also from ACS the Remsen Award. He holds 10 patents. He received his BS degree in chemistry and mathematics at the State University of New York at Albany and his PhD in organic chemistry. In January 2013, he will become Vice Chancellor of Academic Affairs at University of Hawaii, Hilo, which we all envy. NSF, Washington, Hilo? Okay, hard choice. Let me briefly explain how our panel will work. Each panelist is going to give a brief presentation on their views on our session theme, and this will be followed by a short Q&A after each of the presentations. And this Q&A is open to everyone. The first question I'll take will be from someone here in this audience, so start thinking about your questions. After that, we're going to take questions from our virtual audience. For those asking questions in this room, someone will bring you a microphone so everyone can hear you. So please don't start speaking until you either have the microphone or step up to the microphone that's here and here and there. And I will be sure to. I thought someone was going to bring you, but I see there are three microphones standing. For those outside this room, please submit your questions to the panelists by email. And this is the email address, gcehybrid, one word, at acs.org, gcehybrid at acs.org. Questions submitted via the internet will be referred to Dr. Sheldon to relay them to our panelists, and you may direct your question to a specific panelist or leave it open. Now, for all to participate. Now, for those in our audience, and to be fair to those who are listening in, I ask that you speak no more than 60 seconds to ask your question, and be sure you are asking a question, not making a long political commentary. You will hear the following, be concise. This is why I've asked you to be thinking about what they're saying and formulate your questions. You will hear some sound when you've hit 45 seconds, and I'm not sure what that sound is. I'm told there's a sound, but maybe I'll just come and go beep. And I'm told, but I don't know if this is true, that the microphones will actually cut off after 60 seconds. So you don't want to have that happen. So whether you're a chemist, engineer, researcher, policy analyst, managing director, venture capitalist, or a chemistry or engineering student, please think about those questions during the panelists' presentations, and please participate in this discussion. We're going to have a videotaped version of this session online in the next few weeks, along with the questions and answers. And we all, the ACS Green Chemistry Institute, as well as myself, look forward to a global participation and discussion. So we will now get started, and our first panelist is Dr. Cheryl Martin of ARPA-E, and she represents government perspective, or industry, or both.
Good morning. Am I speaking off of my lapel mic? All right, we'll kill this one then. I'm really glad to be here. I have been at ARPA-E for 9 months, so as Madeline pointed out, I have a lot more experience on the industry view of this, but I think we do have some really interesting perspectives between what we're doing at ARPA-E and what Matthew's going to talk about with NSF today of the role government can play in moving to a more sustainable future. I'm going to look a little bit here at just the history of ARPA-E. I want to make sure everybody understands what's our role in the energy ecosystem, and then talk a little bit about specific areas in which we've been funding to give you a flavor for the types of things we're active in, and just mainly to tee up the questions for the next part of the session. The mission of ARPA-E is twofold, to enhance the economic and energy security of the United States, and to ensure the U.S. technological lead in both the development and deployment of advanced energy technologies. And so it's an interesting piece for us. We play very far back in the pipe. For those of you familiar with technical readiness levels, we're way back at 2-3. You know, it's not science. It's not demonstrating first scientific principles, but we might be dotting a few I's and crossing a few T's there. And we're not running down an applied program. We're in the middle of that. But at the same time that we're asking researchers to solve really, really hard technical problems, we're also asking them to think about the marketplace. And we spend a lot of resources. We actually require they spend 5% of their budget doing technology to market activities. And I have a whole team of folks who actually work with them to help them understand their markets and where they're going. And it's a very, very important piece of our mission. We will ultimately fail if we don't end up with technologies in the marketplace. The key focuses of our research are around the three aspects of reducing energy-related emissions, reducing energy imports, and improving energy efficiency. So if you look at it from energy security, economic security, and environmental security is kind of how we like to talk about it quite a bit. ARPA-E is a very, very young agency. We were envisioned in 2006 in the Rising Above the Gathering Storm report, which was commissioned by the National Academies. And in that report, they looked at the DARPA model for bringing research forward and said that we needed that type of agency, program manager-driven, pushing ideas forward, restricted terms. All of our program directors are 3 years and out, so people are very mission-focused on what they came in for, to push energy forward. And so we were actually founded in 2007 as part of America Competes, but like many things in government, we had no money, so we didn't really actually do anything until 2009. We got our first funding as part of the Recovery Act, $400 million. Since that time, we've become part of the Department of Energy's line item budgets, and so we actually this year have a budget of $275 million that we're currently putting to work and in a very funding proposals I'll talk about in a minute. In total, we've funded $500 million worth of projects, 180 projects. Our goal is $3 to $4 million across a three-year time frame. And we look at it in two different ways. But always for us, we look at the research we fund needs to change the learning curve, right? There's a huge, wonderful part of DOE, the applied areas, that are driving down varying of the existing technologies, solar, wind, building efficiency, down existing learning curves and funding the research to do that. Our job is to actually look for things that at deployment, so at whatever you want to say about cost and performance, but as it moves forward, could actually be both transformative and disruptive to current technologies. So can you fund something that would radically change our view of electric vehicles so that they would operate without subsidy, perhaps? Often we have both technical performance targets and cost targets as well, with, again, the idea of moving to technologies that can compete on their own. Part of our mandate as well is that many, many things we start will fail. They will fail because the technology won't work. And so we don't ask ourselves, when we're in a review panel session, we don't ask the reviewers to tell us, will it work? We're saying, if it works, will it matter? And so it's a very, very unique niche in the energy funding space that we hold. And if you look at how that comes together for us, we got what makes the project. It has impact in both what it can do and is it a large market? Well, in energy, generally, pretty large markets. Will it be transformational? Does it challenge what's possible today? Does it disrupt existing learning curves? Can it leap over today's technologies? Does it bridge science and technology? So is it in that space, right? Again, we won't go all the way back to fundamental science. And is it a place where if we de-risk it with the money that we're going to deploy, will somebody else pick it up and move it forward? Variety of things, so spin-outs to companies, funding from strategics, other agencies. We work closely with the Department of Defense, who has a very significant mission around energy. And then we look for team, which is really the key ingredient when you're putting together groups of people working on problems in the energy sector. You often are bringing together different disciplines. We actually have been very actively trying to get folks who don't normally think about the science or the engineering that they bring being applicable to energy to come think about the problems. When you get out into management systems for batteries and you get into sensors and these things, there's a lot of different aspects of science that can be brought to bear. But we really focus on, do they have the right team to go after the problem they're going to tackle? Our program development cycle is actually very interesting, I think. I, coming from industry, I wasn't in the grant knowledge space before I got here. But we move through these four areas: envision, engage, execute, and establish. Basically, a program director will come in with an idea and say, you know, here, I'm thinking of this new way of, you know, we should have permanent magnets able to be made with no rare earth component. And they'll kind of test that. Does it pass the giggle test among all the staff at ARPA-E? And if it passed the giggle test, then they get a workshop together where they're literally called together people, experts existing in the field, and experts that we think might have insights about other approaches to the problem, and they'll actually debate this. And we've run many workshops where the conclusion afterwards is, cool area, but not an ARPA-E-funded type of space. But if we do come through the workshop deciding that that is a place we want to fund, we'll develop the program, put it out for solicitations, have a review panel of the incoming proposals, and an interesting aspect of ours as well is because we're going after the edge, where maybe the reviewers you have know the space, but they might know it traditionally, we actually have a rebuttal period. So we'll feed back to our applicants the feedback from the reviewers, and they have 72 hours to write a 3-4-page rebuttal of the comments from the reviewers. So if there's something we missed, again, it's not perfect, but trying to come up with a way that you can get the best thinking out there at that cutting edge. And then we select programs and then move forward. And my team's engaged both in the early stages of looking at a space as well as out on the edge of the process space when we're thinking about who do these awardees need to know to move these things forward? What about the markets that they're in? And in the energy space, the battery market's very, very different than the grid market. And so who you interact with, what questions you ask, what you need to know, very, very different. About half our awardees are academic, about a third are small businesses, and the remaining 10-plus percent are larger companies, national labs, and nonprofits. The last two slides I have are around what we've actually funded so far. So back in 2009, when we were moving Recovery Act money, we did an open FOA, funding opportunity. We funded 37 projects out of 3,700 concept papers. So it was a very, very massive exercise in trying to figure out, what to fund. But you can see a wide variety of things, biomass to energy, some solar fuels, we had carbon capture projects, we had wind. Really looked at what does the community think is important in energy. And then after that, we've funded 11 different program areas, shown on this slide. And they really go to three buckets, and I think of interest probably to this group. In transportation, we've done both liquid fuels in our electrofuels program. So can you totally turn the idea of electrofuels to electrofuels? Do you need plants at all? Can you take CO2 plus a source of electrons and feed it to non-photosynthetic microbes to actually generate fuel? And that program's been running for several years. We've got a few awardees who've actually been able to generate, you know, I guess we're not at, you know, thousands of barrels a day yet, but they're actually able to generate in the laboratory good size amounts of fuel directly. So technically, like a carbon capture going to fuel, which would be very, very interesting. We've also said around our program called PETRA, we always name them with acronyms, usually late at night, sleep-deprived ideas. So don't ask me what they are because I'll trip over them. But PETRO is about can you actually take, can you get plants to be less plant-like, which they've spent millions of years evolving to, and get them to be more fuel-like? So can you take the best characteristics of algae, right? They make oils really, really well. And there's issues, though, with harvesting, and we can go into those, or algae. But can you have transition those traits into tobacco so that you could have a tobacco plant actually producing oil in a way that is you know, very, very efficient from a growth on land? It grows, we have a supply chain for it, and all those aspects. Loblolly pine today produce about 7% terpenoid components naturally. Can you actually engineer that plant to produce upwards of 20% of those same terpenoids so you can totally rethink the idea of the tree as an energy source? If we shift over to electric vehicles, we run battery efficiency projects looking at can you get twice the performance at a third the cost of an electric vehicle battery, again, trying to move the needle. 400 watt-hours per kilo. We just had one of the awardees report that world record performance a few months ago. So very, very interesting goings on in the transportation space. End-use efficiency, most of energy management is actually heat management, so we cover the spectrum of projects looking at thermal systems. We've also done air conditioning. Air conditioning, as you know, sitting in this room, it's inherently an inefficient process, right? We tend to use temperature to dehumidify the air, and then we tend to warm it up so that we don't all freeze. Is there a way to actually change and run a much more efficient energy curve? Military is very, very interested in this approach, right? We've got bases around the world in very, very hot places where they would like to be much more energy efficient. And so it's a place where we've been partnering with a few of these services looking at what's next after we fund this. And then in the wide area of stationary power, everything from carbon capture projects, power electronics, looking at partnering with our a bigger DOE on Sunshot, which is to drive the cost of solar down. Our small piece is on the actual electronics and the inverters for that system. Grid level storage. A huge question, right? If you're going to have all this renewable generation, how are you going to integrate it? What's the rampable storage look like? We set metrics to have it equal to pumped hydro, which is about the cheapest source of grid-level rampable storage that you can get. We've also have a project called Genie, which is the software and the hardware that development that would be required to make the grid routable, right? We can route the internet, but we can't route the grid. And so some very, very hard software problems, but as well just the whole question about, you know, the hardware that you'd need to transform this. And then the last project of REACT, which is around permanent magnets with little or no rare earth components. So you can see we cover a very wide stretch of the energy space. The ones we have open right now, so I don't have them up there. We've not funded them yet. They're in process. We have another open FOA. We thought it would be a good idea for the community to tell us what's going on. So we'll be probably towards the fall concluding that one. We've got one on natural gas for passenger vehicles. Can you redesign the tank system for passenger vehicles and the charging system to allow you to use the infrastructure that exists, at least here in the U.S., the home infrastructure for natural gas, to give you vehicles that could be run on that gas, given the, you know, the abundance that we're seeing right now, and as well energy management systems. As you look across many of these things, they are linked systems, right? Our batteries are large because of we want to go a certain distance, and they're expensive, so we're trying to set metrics for a higher energy density. But another way to look at this is our batteries are large because we don't understand what happens to the battery through its duty cycle. So we've got a huge safety margin. And the whole question of can you do energy management and understand the health of a battery so that you could truly change what's possible. So again, a lot of exciting things that we're funding and continuing to fund. It's really fun. I'm having a blast 9 months into this job, and would look forward to your questions and the discussion with the rest of the panel. Thank you.
Well, thank you very, very much, Cheryl. That was a really interesting description of what is being done at ARPA-E. And so we'll now take questions. We'll start with questions from the audience here. And I see somebody heading to the microphone. And Cheryl, you can answer your questions from just where you're sitting. First person over here.
Al Matbach, University of Delaware. The assumption seems to be made that every driver will have his own car and he will drive alone in it. And we are seeking technological solutions to make the car more efficient. But it doesn't have to be that way. We might be able to devise a carrot stick system for getting more than one person in a car. Revenue neutral, where those who insist on driving alone would pay for the rest. So what do you think of that?
I'd be happy to ride with you since I don't have a car. but certainly the Department of Transportation and a lot of the different agencies looking at infrastructure solutions look at that whole idea of moving, you know, a lot of people together, right? The investments in mass transportation as well as ride sharing. In my small piece of the Department of Energy, we're focused on the technical solutions for the massive amount of vehicles that will exist around the world no matter what, no matter what else we come up with. So appreciate your observation.
Well, back in about 1992, the EPA proposed such a system, and they were going forward with it until Newt Gingrich gained control of the Congress.
Okay, thank you. We'll move right on to the next question, and I want to remind our international audience to please send your questions in. Next question.
Yeah, Rich Engler, EPA. One thing that
you can fix his problem.
I'll get right on that tomorrow, Al. One of the things I saw missing in your portfolio was industrial energy use. And is that something that you're thinking about or you haven't really looked at? But certainly this year's SciTech, who won this year's Presidential Green Chemistry Challenge Award, is showing tremendous results in improving the energy efficiency in converting bauxite to alumina. So it strikes me that there's an opportunity here.
Right. We have absolutely been looking at it. We've run a few, I call them mini workshops, nascent workshops, looking at everything from thermal with water recycling inside industrial systems. Are there other ways to think about it? The whole idea, we had a funding workshop on, can you go to smaller modular reactor systems and actually can you change? The whole idea always is if you scale up a plant, you get more efficiency. And we were actually trying to challenge that whole question in a workshop. We did not yet decide to fund that, but it's an area of which we have pretty significant focus among the staff. And actually, if you have ideas, I'd love to talk to you about them.
Okay. Awesome. Thanks.
Thank you. Other questions from our audience here in Washington? Yes, over here.
Yes, Sonia Salmon from Novozymes. Kind of along the same lines of the question just asked, I noticed in your original funding round for ARPA-E, you had one project in the building efficiency area. And at least as I've heard it, building efficiency really is one of those places that if there were some really good changes, you could save a lot of energy. So I was just wondering, what is your outlook on that? Do you see people coming with proposals, or is this very incremental? How do you see that?
No, I certainly, our Beat It project, which we ran in our next round of funding after that open FOA, is all about energy efficiency. It was very much focused on the air conditioning system, because that is certainly from a building efficiency point of view, a place of big impact. So we have, there's about $40 million in that project going towards about 15 different efforts to change the whole way we think about HVAC systems. We've also looked at, as part of our broader heat management system, our heat management project does everything from, you know, inside your car, right, heating and cooling in electric vehicles a problem because you're going to tap your battery. And so the whole question of can you use thermal generation in your car in a better way. So we have a number of projects where we believe there's a chance to really step change. And then in the broader part of DOE, we have a massive effort in the building sector at energy efficiency. Everything from true technical systems to energy efficiency apps where people can understand their energy better, partnerships with the utilities who are looking at this. So for the Department of Energy, it's a huge focus. For us, it's probably about 15% of what we've funded so far. And again, because where we've seen technology leaps able to move, not just for the impact overall.
Dr. Sheldon, I believe we have a question from a visitor, someone who's listening in.
Yeah. I see there's a question from Japan. And the question is, what are some of the green engineering principles that you can highlight as potential opportunities for small businesses?
Cheryl? Or anybody? But these are supposed to be aimed at Cheryl.
I think that when you're looking at green energy writ large, I think the rest of the panelists will have some insight on this. As I look at what we think about in the energy space of this, I think there's quite a few opportunities, right? We've seen batteries, you know, storage in general being a place where there can be small businesses making components for batteries and potentially partnering with some of the larger players to make whole systems. I think we may see, in the motors markets, certainly in the energy efficiency space, a number of places where small businesses exist. Even in some of your alternatives for fuels, although I do think as they get bigger, it's a lot easier to see a path to market in partnership, at least, with some of the larger companies. But I think those are some of the ones I'd see as most likely to be accessible for small business.
Thank you very much, Cheryl. We're now going to go on to our next panelists. We do have questions coming in, but they're more generalized, and we're going to wait for the this big discussion. So now Adam Monroe of Novozymes is going to represent the industrial perspective.
Well, thank you. We can get this first slide up here. Oh, it's that back one. There we go. Sorry. So there, now I can see it there as well. So when some of my guys talked to me about the fact that I'd get to talk at this conference at the American Chemical Society, I got really excited. As a chemical engineer, I thought, this is my chance to talk to my people. And I could talk all day about enzymes and the fact that we've won two presidential green chemistry awards and really get down into the weeds on that, and I would love to do that. But that is not what I'm going to talk about today, because that's not what I'm charged with. I am charged with talking to you about how can business promote and play a role in advancing the cause here, which is green chemistry. And certainly enzymes fit that principles of green chemistry in many, many ways, from energy efficiency to catalysis, you name it. Our company has been providing good economic solutions to our customers for decades. We've been producing enzymes since the 60s. But in 2000, we really started to think about this differently as a company. When we were IPO'd out of Novo Nordisk, we thought about our vision as a company and how should that be different because of the way we looked at the world. So it wasn't just about better business. It was about using these bio-based solutions to make for better lives and for better environment, and that we could change the world. But we couldn't do it alone. We had to do that with our customers. So as we pursued that over the last 12 years to try to live up to that vision, it really started to uncover some new and different perspectives for us. When we look at enzymes, certainly we focus on the customer and what it can do for them. But we also now, as many of us in this room understand, there are huge pressures in the world on resources. We're all starting to look at the world differently. that the natural resources of the planet are constrained, the consumption of these materials is faster than we can rejuvenate them, etc. So now, as a company, we have a whole panel of life cycle assessment people, LCA people, some of the best in the world. And they've assessed our products and their impact on just one of these elements, which is CO2 emissions. And you can see that on the slide. Just last year alone, the effect of using a natural solution, a green chemistry solution, had the impact of 45 million tons of CO2 reductions, which is like 17 million cars taken off the road. Well, I think when you look at it from a business perspective, I mean, the technology is nice, but one of the things that we do today is when we look at our what's in our R&D pipeline, we make these assessments for not only CO2 and what will it mean from that life cycle, but what will it mean for water? What will it mean for society? And we actually make some differentiation on what we might launch based upon those kinds of criteria. Don't get me wrong, the financial part of that is incredibly important. But it's about looking at the world differently. It really comes down to two things. One is changing your perspective as a business. And the other is using all the connections you have in a very, very different way. So if we step back in time just a little bit, we go back somewhere between the Industrial Revolution and, for somebody who was born in 66, somewhere in the early 70s, we started to think like this. We started to think about the reputation of the company, and government started to put in regulations to handle some of the many things that some of us are have black eyes over, you know, environmental issues, et cetera. But it was all about, could I live up and often to the line of the regulation, and can I avoid a reputational disaster? And certainly none of us want reputational disasters today. But that has changed. That is not the world we're in today. Our customers' customers, society, is starting to think a lot more about where could this be? Could we, as Cheryl mentioned, could we have new solutions and create totally new markets? And that is a lot about what our business is about today. Today, it's not about just having a laundry detergent that can remove a stain that we can provide an enzyme for. It's also about having a laundry detergent that might save the customer, the consumer money, but also save energy, reduce the amount of phosphorus that could be in the formulation, et cetera. So that's where we are today, and I think we're on a nice trend. But what I'll talk about in a minute is that tomorrow there is a huge development coming, totally new models coming through these two elements of a different perspective and using different connections to make it happen. And I'll give you a couple of examples. So, if any of you have a sales department, and I'm sure you do, you've heard focus on the customer. And don't kid me here, it's very important to focus on the customer. But somewhere around the birth of supply chain management, we started to think about, well, what are our customers demanding? And in meeting those demands, what if we ask some of our suppliers to help us with the solutions? That was a tremendous and good effort. But where we're headed is to also start to understand not only what the government regulations are, but what's shaping them. What's the public opinion? Where is, you know, the young generation going, and what are they thinking about, to what are the NGOs thinking about, to understanding the global trends around resources, water scarcity, you name it. And if you start to broaden that horizon and look at it very differently, it starts to shape what you might think of as potential solutions. And I'll give you a couple of examples. This is an example of the sort of today's scenario where we started to think about our solutions in the laundry detergent space very differently. We've been making enzymes for the laundry business since the 60s. Our first protease came out, I think, in 1965, somewhere in that range. And it's been a wonderful business for us. But today, when we think about detergent solutions, we think about, well, how could we affect energy? How could we affect phosphorus? And why are we doing that? Well, we know that government is thinking about those things, the mineral aspects of these things, the waste impact of these things. And we know that energy is on the agenda all over the world. So if we can find solutions that affect both energy and mineral resources, and by the way, we can save money for the consumer at home because we can lower their energy bill, that might make a good business. And so we did. And I think you may have seen some of the things around here talking about cold water wash. So today, there is a formulation you can use which lowers the temperature at home, which, by the way, has huge impacts. I had no idea how much energy went into heating water to wash clothes. But it's not just good enough to even build the business model. You have to think about, well, how can we connect that to society? How can we work across that broader perspective to make that happen? So we as a company started to venture outside of our business to business shell to see, could we shape that? And I'm not saying we're successful at it yet, but we are trying. And as we try, we uncover new insight and understanding, what shapes public opinion, etc. So what you see on the slide here is we ran a campaign in Europe called I Do 30. And what that means is we'd like to encourage you to wash your clothes below 30 degrees C. The way we did that is we said, you know, let's get out to the sixth largest rock festival in all of Europe, which happens to be in our headquarter country of Copenhagen, or of Denmark. And this is at the Roskilde Music Festival. It goes on for like 10 days, and it rains a lot in Denmark. So here was the trick. The trick was, bring us your warm beer. We'll exchange it for cold beer. And while you're at it, bring us your laundry, and we'll wash it. And while you're drinking the cold beer, hanging out, waiting for your laundry to get washed, we'll talk to you about the impacts of how you could save energy at home. Now, I can tell you that the range of responses from that was fascinating. There is definitely a trend among men that they don't do laundry. But there was quite a bit of interest on two fronts. One, saving money, but a bigger one, especially among the younger generation, was this thing about saving energy. So we did our best to pump that out through social media, et cetera, to build some following. Well, hey, you know, I don't know how many of you have ever heard of the I Do 30 campaign, but it's probably not a lot of you. But what it did do is it created some new connections for us, some new questions for us. What could you do this? And that's been very, very fruitful. The statistics are there on the screen. It's a huge impact if we can move from hot water to cold water. It's $1 billion in energy bills a year alone in the United States. So it's pretty significant stuff. But I want to talk to you about that future world that we're coming to, the one where totally new business models are going to emerge. And this is a lot about really looking out there farther down into the value chain, if you will, and working together. So our CEO had a vision, as CEOs often do. And he said, you know, I think we can create the bio-based economy, something that he talks a lot about, and now I'm very happy that the President of the United States is also talking about. And what he's basically trying to show is that we can produce food, fuel, materials, and everything else we need from renewable sources of carbon. And it's not something that's just going to happen in the largest industrialized countries of the world where the biggest ag centers are based. He said, I think we can do this in the poorest parts of the world in some of the most extreme conditions at a very, very small scale. So we launched with an intention the Africa project in Mozambique. The intention was to do a food energy venture on a very small scale. So what we did is we rounded up some of our friends in the space, biofuels producers, ag guys who understood agriculture and agroforestry and some other things and said, okay, how can we make this work on a very small scale? When we got there, what we thought we were going to do was to produce fuel and food. What we discovered was there was a much bigger societal issue around deforestation and particulate matter inside of homes where the cooking occurred using charcoal, which came from the burning of the forest. So the venture took a whole nother turn. And so our partners and us got together and we built So we started with agroforestry. So sustainable agriculture where you have nut trees and legumes to put nitrogen in the soil and cassava being grown for the starch resource. And we established a group of farmers, 500 farmers, with the goal of increasing their income, producing more food than they consume, which is often the case in Africa. They just make enough to eat. And then do this other stuff we had intended. Well, the results were astounding. Along with our partner, Domatic, within Clean Star, providing cook stoves, we set up a system where 500 farmers have increased their income by fourfold. They're producing excess food. They are now selling, in this case, ethanol made from cassava into Maputo for these clean cook stoves. So it wasn't about transportation fuel at all. It was about clean fuel to burn inside the house. By the way, these particulate matters results in a 40% stunted growth rate in Mozambique for the children there. 40% of kids are stunted. So in the first year alone, the 2,000 cook stoves that we set aside to sell in the first year disappeared within like 2 months. It was incredible. And now we're looking at next year something on the order of 2,000 farmers, and I don't know how many stoves that equates to, but a much larger number. And it's highly successful. And it's about how we changed our view. Who knows if that's going to become a billion-dollar business for us, but it's certainly going to become a nice business at the base of the pyramid in a part of the world where we have a serious issue. So that probably, though, will breed, and I know it has, because the guys in Haiti, as soon as they found out about this, came to me and said, hey, can you do that in Haiti? And we said, sure we can. Now, that's going to require some new partners and some new things. But the point is, it points out a new model because of the way we looked at things differently. So my challenge to all of you is to see how far out you can look, how broad you can look. Take the partners that you know and find some new ones and see what you can come up with, because often when you start asking these questions and putting these challenges out there, you'll get questions you never thought about, but you likely have technology solutions for. So with that, I'll leave it there.
Thank you for that very, very fascinating presentation. We have questions for Adam from the audience or from our guests listening in from around the world. Somebody is headed to the microphone. Okay. Thank you.
Yes, good morning. Rich Chappas, Delaware Sustainable Chemistry Alliance. Just really appreciated your insights on base of the pyramid effects on business. Worked with Stu Hart at Cornell, and I think this really engenders a lot of opportunities for new business. I was curious as to specifically what were some of the maybe places that fit into your existing portfolio, or were you looking at this as more just an opportunity to grow outside of where you're business focus is today?
You know, honestly, I think where this started was with something I think all of us in this room struggle with, which is how do we get society to understand what we could do for them? And that's where our CEO was. He said, I just want to prove it, you know? And then as we got into trying to prove it, we started to understand, gosh, that could be unique, smaller scale businesses that might add up to something even larger. So it was really as simple as that. Now it has become, it has really become a discussion about exactly what you're asking, which is, well, where else at the base of the pyramid, if you will, can we find opportunities, whether it's to help with a water issue or another type of resource issue?
We have a question from South Africa. And that question, Dr. Sheldon, it's disappeared, but I think that you can remember it.
I can remember roughly what it was, because it's disappeared now. There's a question from South Africa, and we could have probably...
There it is.
There it is.
Okay.
And the question is, what are some collaborative opportunities for other organizations to assist in the food energy initiative?
Yeah, that's a really good question, because we get a lot of people asking that question. And I think the first start to that answer is really about not only finding us, but to go into the forums, whether it be anything from the UN Global Compact type forums or forums like this one, because it's not just us that have solutions. It's people like the people in this room with green chemistry. So it's about going out and finding green solution spaces and then coming in with your questions. Can you do this? Can you do that? Because I am sure there are plenty of people who have just as good of solutions as we have. But outside of contacting me and our company in any form or fashion, I don't know that I have a great answer to that other than to say a lot of groups are out there trying to help with that, to try to make those kind of things happen.
Okay. We have another question.
Yes, Bob Peoples from the ACS Green Chemistry Institute. I really love the statistical information you gave on the CO2 impacts. The experience tells us that from a synthetic point of view, shifting from organic solvents to water, running reactions at room temperature. Do you have any data on quantifying the energy savings and the solvent avoidance savings associated with shifting to enzyme-based catalytic systems?
Certainly on the, well, let me back up. When we do these LCAs, it's from cradle to grave. So for those of you who understand those systems, they're huge databases with data on every element of the entire chain. So I'm sure within that somewhere, we're able to say, well, where did we avoid whatever, solvent, water, energy? Certainly because it's a catalysis situation in a very specific reaction, there alone is the whole secret. Why nature invented enzymes in the first place, which has a lot to do with not using excess energy and not producing other byproducts. So enzymes by themselves are very efficient in that manner. But as it relates to direct solvent, I'm sure give us the application and we could tell you.
Okay. Any other questions for Adam? Here we go. We have someone going to the mic.
Hi, Dawn Chang from Dow Chemical. Speaking of LCAs and your reference earlier on trying to influence consumer behavior, going to a rock concert's awesome. I think that would be great. But even as a scientist, when I do laundry, there's in the back of my mind, even though I know the surfactants are going to get it clean at lower temperature, there's part of me that's still convinced that I have to go higher if I want to decontaminate.
Right.
So how do you think you can influence consumers' behaviors in a broader sense, maybe translating science in layman's terms, like we heard yesterday from the ACS president? So I even as a scientist, I still struggle with these images and paradigms locked in my head about how to do things.
You know, that's a great question because we struggle with that one ourselves every day about how do we do this. And I'll give you a look. Anybody who's got a creative way, and I think many of the branded companies in here are good at this, can help to educate consumers on this. But the other way that we do this, which is a little harder, you know, we work within, for instance, the Sustainability Consortium to get to help educate retailers about the potentials and to help them drive suppliers into more energy efficient, better solutions, et cetera, through consistent scientific measurements about so people can compare their products. And sometimes that's an uncomfortable place to be if you're a supplier, and certainly we are, but it's also one that drives education for consumers. Suddenly when they can compare energy consumption on whatever, a box of cereal, they start to think about, well, why? And it leads to more questions. And I think if big consumer companies are going to drive that, it will also help to educate the consumer. Beyond that, it is about any creative way we can find, whether it's rock concerts or great advertisements on television. I don't have a great answer for that one.
When you think about, though, the nutrition labels and how that has really changed consumer attitudes, just think if you had a life cycle label on every product, how it might really do that. I'm going to just take one moment as the moderator's prerogative to thank the Dow Chemical Company as well as all the other sponsors of this conference. But I want to give a special shout out to Dow, since our questioner was from Dow, for being the sole sponsor of the International Chemistry Olympiad, which will bring 285 students from 72 nations, many, I'm sure, nations that are listening in on this conference, to Washington, D.C. next month to compete for the best and the brightest minds in chemistry, which will be hired by all your companies someday. So thank you, Dow Chemical, but thank all the other sponsors for making this conference possible. Dr. McClellan.
Yes, Madeline, thanks very much. At Nina McClellan, University of Toledo, the title of this is The Role of Government, Industry, and Academe. And I have heard nothing about academia. You got a lot of us in the room. Matt, if this is a shot at you, I apologize. I hope you're going to touch on what I need to know. What are we not doing that we could do to help more? How could we do things better? I want to come away with knowing how are we performing, and that's my question to you.
Well, I think that's a great segue to Matt. And Matt now is going to rewrite his entire talk in the next 10 seconds that it takes him to come up here. We now have Matt Platz from the National Science Foundation, Director of Chemistry Division, and he will be talking about whatever he plans to talk about. So, see, we should be here. There we go. Okay.
Well, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. It's a pleasure to be here, I think. that's yet to be determined, but actually, it is a pleasure to be here to tell you about the National Science Foundation and our new program, Sustainable Chemistry, Engineering, and Materials. Let me start at the beginning and tell you a little bit about the NSF. First of all, we are in our 62nd year. We are a part of the executive branch of government. We do not report up through a cabinet secretary. Our director, Subra Suresh, was appointed by President Obama and confirmed by the Senate. And so we report up through the chain of the command directly to the president. And those of us who work at the NSF, the 1,400 of us who work there, really are the staff of the president to implement his agenda and his vision for science in the United States. The NSF was largely the brainchild of Vannevar Bush, father and grandfather of presidents of the United States. Our mission is to fund the best chemistry in the United States that comes to us from qualifying institutions, largely academic institutions in the United States. In the Division of Chemistry, we receive 1,800 proposals a year, approximately. We fund approximately 380. Our core business is to run a peer review process, which is viewed in the world as the gold standard, to identify the best proposals and to fund the best science. A part of our mission is also workforce development to educate the workers of the future, and so we are very concerned with the pipeline of scientists and as well as the pipeline of science. The story of the SUSCAM program begins in January of 2011 when President Obama reauthorized the America Competes Act. And within the ACA, Section 509 explicitly called upon the National Science Foundation to establish a sustainable chemistry basic research program, or a green chemistry basic research program. The Act itself uses the term green and sustainable interchangeably. Probably the aficionados in this audience know they're comparable. There's much overlap, but they're not exactly the same thing. So beginning in January of 2011, we undertook a period of introspection and a period of outreach that helped us define the goals of the Sustainable Chemistry, Engineering, and Materials program. And for us at NSF, it's very important that our program be unique and be differentiated from those of other agencies, for example, the DOE or the EPA, because quite frankly, if we do the same thing in these other agencies, that's viewed as waste and duplication. So one of our boundary conditions when we create a new program, of course, is to do something unique and different from the other agencies. Being a reductionist scientist, I always try to look for root causes of events. And this slide, which I've taken from a Goldman Sachs report, is as close as I can come to explaining much of what's going on in the world economy and much of what's going on in world politics right now. Over the last 15 years, there's been a 50% increase in the number of middle-class consumers around the world, and most of this growth has taken place in Asia. And if you look at projections over the next generation, over the next 25 years, the number of middle-class consumers, which used to be 1 billion and is now 1.5 billion, is expected to grow to 4 billion individuals. Well, moving hundreds of millions of people, moving billions of people out of poverty and into a middle-class status is obviously a wonderful development for the world, but it is not without some challenges, not without some transition issues. Here is some data from the United States Department of Labor, which shows that in the previous decade, the multinational corporations cut their employment in the United States by 2.9 million jobs and added 2.4 million jobs overseas. Given this previous slide, it's not difficult to understand why employment is migrating. Multinational corporations are probably deciding that they want to increasingly move their operations closer to their markets where they are now and where they expect them to be later. And we also see this as increased competition for natural resources. And probably the most commonly used example is petroleum. At a time, during a period when the number of middle-class consumers increased by 50%, the supply of petroleum only increased by 15%. And when you apply the law of supply and demand, it's not very difficult to realize that when demand increases faster than supply, the price will go up. And we all see that on a daily basis at the pump. This is but one example of the competition for natural resources. I direct your attention to a fascinating study of the National Research Council of 4 years ago, which talked about minerals, critical minerals in the U.S. economy. And I'll read from this that every year, More than 25,000 pounds of new non-fuel minerals must be provided for each person in the United States to make the items that we use every day. Here is a commodity index, again taken off of an investment firm website. This commodity index is based upon the price of many things, particularly chemicals, fertilizer, uranium, copper, platinum, etc. And you can see that for most of the 20th century, absent a world war or an oil embargo, the price of raw materials was steadily decreasing. But then at about the time the world middle class population began to explode, so did the price of all these non-fuel commodities. And there are many economists who believe that the Great Recession we're now suffering within is a consequence of $150 a barrel gasoline. That was the trigger that really set off the Great Recession. And they warn us that we might be in a really unfortunate cycle in which when the world economy slows, demand for gasoline drops, the price drops, then economic activity spikes back up, and the cycle starts over again. As the price of gasoline goes up, then we're due for another crash. Many of you have probably heard about Hubbard's Law. Hubbard was an engineer with Shell Oil in the 1940s and 50s. He came up with a series of equations to predict the life cycle of natural resources. Hubbard predicted that the U.S. production of petroleum would peak in the late 1960s, and that was correct. His equations predict that the world production of petroleum will peak in, well, is at peak right now, or maybe was at peak 2 or 3 years ago, and will start to quickly decrease in the 2020s. If you apply Hubbard's equations to many other raw materials beyond petroleum, there are predictions, and they are highly controversial, that world demand for certain chemicals will outpace our ability to produce them at some point this century. Phosphorus for fertilizer is high on the list. Lithium for batteries, it won't really help us in transportation if we come up with a great energy-efficient lithium battery if there's not enough lithium to go around to build it all. The same is true for gallium, indium in particular, semiconductors for photovoltaics. You know, if we are going to put photovoltaics on every roof, will we have enough tellurium to make that happen? Predictions are that we probably will not. The rare earth elements are not rare, but because one country has cornered the market on production, it is subject to political and man-made scarcity. And so the NSF Division of Chemistry decided to come up with these following four priorities. There are other parts of the NSF that are playing in SusChem. For example, materials research, earth sciences, chemical engineering, electrical engineering. I direct you to their websites. Their priorities will be slightly different. There is opportunities for collaboration. There's opportunities for synergy here. But remember our core mission. Our core mission in the NSF Division of Chemistry is to receive, review, and then fund the best proposals that come to us. We do not operate laboratories. We do not have facilities. Only 6% of our funds go for operations or overhead. 94% of the funding is passed through to you, the community, who submit the best proposals. And so the SusChem priorities for us are to fund the discovery of new chemistry that will allow the world to replace rare, expensive, and/or toxic chemicals with earth-abundant, inexpensive, and benign chemicals. One of our priorities is in the area of separation science, so that we can come up with new separation science so that we can economically, which means at low energy cost, recycle chemicals that cannot be easily replaced. We seek to fund the discovery of new synthetic chemistry that can use biorenewable sources of organics to make feedstock chemicals as opposed to relying on petroleum. And we want to fund the discovery of new environmental friendly chemistry, chemical reactions that can run at room temperature and require the consumption of less clean water, require less energy, and release less organic solvent than current practice. This program will be operationalized through our single investigator portfolio. The chemistry division is moving to a single submission window. Half of the programs are shown here on this slide. Will receive proposals in September. The other half will receive proposals in October. If you wish to submit a proposal to us in this area, in the title, it should start with the acronym SUSCHEM and then your title. And your single investigator proposal or your collaborative proposal can be sent to any of these programs. If you are a chemist who has never worked in this area before and has an idea to get started in this area, you may submit a supplement proposal to us to hire a student, to put on a student, to work on a new project. Now, Dr. McClellan so kindly asked what the academic community can do better. Here's my answer to you. I'm a perfect exemplar of the curiosity-driven chemist in the academy. I have been working on chemistry that has interested me for many years. I have many decades of support from the NSF and momentum and expertise in areas that have almost no overlap with sustainable chemistry and green chemistry. I think what the Academy needs to do, and what one of the goals of SUSCHEM must be, is to grow a critical mass of talent in this area. I think this is the area that will attract young people into our profession. I think the young people get it. They know the planet's in trouble, and they want to do research that is significant and will make a difference. And this is the area in which it can happen. And my advice to the Academy is to hire and empower those young people. All too often, the Academy is conservative in the sense of being resistant to change, and faculty are too often interested in hiring younger versions of themselves. That's not healthy for our profession or our discipline. President Obama's budget request to Congress for FY13 calls out for $13.8 million in funding in the Division of Chemistry for this priority area. I encourage talent in this country to submit proposals, to think about ways of changing your research into this area, because I predict this will be the growth area for our discipline over the next 30 years. And so, to conclude, we have all looked at the periodic table. We've seen it color-coded at times with the inert elements with one color, the metals versus the nonmetals with another color. Here's a new color-coding scheme which has come to us at NSF from the Center for Sustainable Materials Chemistry at Oregon State and the University of Oregon. in which they color code elements by whether or not they're expensive, inert, radioactive, toxic, or potentially scarce due to either low natural abundance or historical economic factors, but also green, the green elements, the benign elements that are Earth abundant. And so can we learn, can we discover the chemistry we need to discover to make everything we need to have our quality of life from these elements? Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Matt. That was also another really exciting talk. And so now we've heard perspectives from all of our distinguished speakers. We'll start first with some specific questions for Matt, and then we'll open this up for everyone. While people are getting up, there's a question here from Monmouth University in the United States. Are there recommended experiments for college lab courses to emphasize green chemistry? Matt?
The answer is yes. There are many wonderful books out there. I believe Oregon and Oregon State are national leaders in developing a green chemistry laboratory curriculum. I'm sure if you go to their website, you will can get started. I believe they also run a very successful summer school for faculty who want to learn how to develop this curriculum.
We also, at the American Chemical Society, have materials on our website. And I would also say that the summer school, the ACS Green Chemistry and Sustainable Energy Summer School, will be starting in about a week at the Colorado School of Mines. Mm-hmm. And it takes applications from all over the U.S. and from Latin America. So next year, this crop is filled. But next year, if you are a student, this is the kind of thing that we also do in this one-week summer school course. And over here, we have a question.
Hello, Tom Burns with Novozymes. Dr. Platz, we have an international audience both here in the auditorium and also through the video cast. Could you clarify a little bit, as NSF is a U.S. domestic program, if there are researchers who are interested in these projects or making proposals, what the connection could be or what the ground rules are to do that from an international basis?
The NSF funds U.S.-based scientists. Period. We do promote collaborations with scientists from around the world. We expect their home countries to provide matching funds in most cases. It's very easy for this to happen at the grassroots level. For 30 plus years, I've been collaborating with scientists from throughout the world. I have collaborators, connections in many countries. There's no restriction on my NSF, personal NSF grant for me to hire a student or a postdoc from another country, to fly in a scientist from another country. So really, if you're a scientist in another outside the United States, make friends with a U.S.-based scientist. And there are many opportunities for that person to use their NSF funding to work with you. And hopefully that will help you get funding from your home country as well.
Okay. We have a question here.
Al Matlack, the University of Delaware. I know you've been experimenting with different systems of peer review. You've had the standard system where the applicants' names are listed, and you've had the short system of two or three pages where the applicants are anonymous. And then when the funders decided which to fund, there wasn't much agreement between the two. So why do you think that was?
You're right, there has been experiments like that. At this time, all of the proposals coming into the Division of Chemistry are named. We are not reviewing anonymous proposals. The answer to your question is beyond me, and I think requires a real focused research problem by a good social and behavioral scientist.
Very well put. We have a question here in the center.
Hi, Rinus Brokstam on DSM. I think there's a lot of self-education that still has to be done by our collective group of scientists. And I think especially in, if we would be able to do something on editorial policy in mainstream journals, I think it would be very significant. Because at this point in time, there is still relatively little scientific credit in doing green and sustainable things, except, of course, for the specialist journals. So from the pharmaceutical roundtable, of course, we have been at discussions with editorial boards, and there seems to be some scarcity, some fear about losing academic freedom to operate if you would somehow explain more what the green and sustainable elements in your research are. For example, explain how much materials you use in a synthesis instead of just not mentioning that. So I think there's a large element of self-awareness in the scientific community, and I think especially maybe the ACS can play even a more important role in that than they do as they're doing today.
Well, I failed to detect a question there.
So, okay. So how can we actually make sure that people get more scientific credit for if they do green sustainable chemistry things instead of doing pure, what we today consider as pure scientific achievements?
Well, again, that's another cultural question for a social and behavioral scientist, but I think wise university administrators are recognizing that this is the future, that the solution to the great global problems facing the world all require the discovery of some new chemistry. Other disciplines can model and simulate and tell us how bad things are going to get, but we're the scientists who are going to really make the discoveries that fix the problem or mitigate it. And the kids understand this, and I think universities really need to hire faculty with these interests.
I'd also like to add that there are a growing number of journals, of serious journals with high impact factors that are publishing serious research in green and sustainable chemistry. The American Chemical Society has just launched a new journal, ACS Sustainable Chemistry and Engineering, and the editor was here this week, Dr. David Allen from the University of Texas. And I think it's also getting more credibility by publishing in these very high impact journals published by our sister societies and ACS and others. I want to remind the international listeners that you can send questions to gcehybrid@acs.org. I've got a couple people waiting here in Washington, but we are looking forward to taking your questions. Over here.
Thank you very much. Dr. Platz, first of all, I'm Bill Nelson from the University of Illinois. I was thinking, and it came to me from something that was said yesterday, could the NSF, in their solicitations for the SUSCAM, require that the winning applicants participate in a significant way in somehow either via advisory boards or reviews to contribute to the growth of green chemistry on panels or reviews of potential green chemistry projects around the country, in addition to their actually funded project?
Well, let me tell you how things work right now. How things work because of actual laws written in stone. Every 2 years, the President of the United States appoints 8 individuals to serve on the National Science Board for a 6-year term. So there are 24 individuals who are charged with overseeing the NSF, and they determine our merit review criteria. That is not within the purview of anyone else. It's those 24 individuals. And they have decreed that there are 2 criteria that we use. One is intellectual merit, and the second is broader impacts. And broader impact can be demonstrated in a number of ways. It could be in the pipeline. It could be in terms of the kind of service that you have specified. And our reviewers are supposed to evaluate proposals on the basis of those 2 criteria. And oftentimes many proposals have equivalent intellectual merit. and the deciding factor is the broader impacts and how credible they are and how original they are.
Thank you.
One more question for Dr. Platz, and then we will open it up for the whole panel.
Rich Chappas, wearing a different hat, Hope Biofuels, a startup corporation. Could you comment on SBIR, Small Business Innovation Research, and how you envision that both as part of NSF and as a means of promoting sustainable chemistry? I guess, to me, this really builds on the theme that we have here of trying to incorporate academic, industrial, and government, you know, in under one umbrella. Typically, SBIR grants go to, you know, startups out of universities,
right.
And where letters of support come from companies like Novozymes.
Right.
So you've got all those three coming together. It just looks like that is, and again, it's a unique program for the United States. I think there's more we can do with it. I guess my frustration is I know we're struggling a little bit as a company right now, not getting phase two, et cetera, et cetera. But where do you see this as an engine for driving sustainability, as I do, or where do you put this in your perspective?
I view this as a very much underutilized mechanism by our community. Of the approximately 1,800 proposals we receive every year, I could probably count on one hand the number of SBIR-type proposals that we get. Unfortunately, due to the history and culture of our academic community, RPIs do not seem inclined in this direction the way they are in, let's say, engineering. So it's a very underutilized mechanism.
Okay, well, thank you. We are now going to open this up to the entire panel on any question that you have that's relevant, and we'll start with Dr. Shelton introducing a question from a listener in New Zealand.
Yeah, a question from New Zealand for whoever would like to. Well, probably good for an industrial representative. What do the panelists see as the major barriers to global industry adopting green chemistry?
Okay, well,
I can start with that one. You know, look, business is going to start with a cost element to most things. But what will drive green chemistry beyond the cost element is certainly the value society places on it. The trick is that in different parts of the world, society values different things from a green or sustainability perspective. So, as an example, in the United States and in Europe in particular, we understand CO2 effects, safety effects, etc. And I think there's marketplace value for a company to institute greener systems, whether they're addressing all of those or just one. In other parts of the world, India as an example, what society cares about from that aspect is less about CO2 emissions. It's more personal. It's more base of the pyramid economy. So to answer it directly, I think it's a lot about the biggest barrier being making sure society understands what we can bring to the table such that they could then value it. And if you work together, we've worked with partners in India where they start to give solutions in smaller packages that the mother figure in a family in the countryside can then turn into a business, starts to become very valuable. And so the green element of that being that when they dispose of the material or whatever it is, it's biodegradable, suddenly becomes a very important thing in that part of the world. So to me, it's a lot about working with media, the community, society, to educate them as being the biggest barrier, because if they value it, then industry will start to incorporate it if it's to be beyond just a pure cost savings exercise.
Anyone else on the panel want to add anything?
I fully agree. I think my experience in industry and looking at how we talk about what's going to be the value of the energy technologies is about the fact it has to have value, right? There's a definition of innovation that I just love. It's attributable to one of the people at Intel. Innovation is
people creating value through the implementation of new ideas. So if you don't have people working together and you don't have value, which is only defined by the market, by the people at the end of this of the value chain, and you're doing something, all you have is your idea. And if we really think about it for all businesses, that's what you have to think about, right? And how you create the value mostly is through your customer needs. We can't cut our costs as a permanent way of doing business. It's helpful. It certainly can drive interest in a first project. But ultimately, a lot of it is about being able to define it as a value proposition.
Okay. We have a question over here.
Hello, I'm Wes Austin from Satori Pharmaceuticals. In the market today, established technologies have advantages from the economies of scale relative to emerging technologies. What, from a policy perspective, would the panel recommend to incubate and push those emerging technologies towards the tipping point so they can stand on their own?
From a policy perspective, I think that requires wiser people than me. But I do think a lot of the way we've looked at how do you get energy technologies through those dual valleys of death, or valleys of pain, depending on how you look at it. I prefer to think of it as pain. A lot of it is about understanding what has to happen to demonstrate the next step. So what size is relevant for the end game, what data is relevant for the end game, and who can participate in that. And I think as we've worked with folks from energy, folks like EPRI, the Electrical Research, Electrical Power Research Institute, their members are all of the PUCs and member power generating agencies in the United States. They fund this research agency to get them research understood and deployed. And so we partner with them so that there's data at a significant level for those members to then decide that they're going to step up. And so I think that's how you're going to deal with new technology getting credibility to go to the next scale, some ways. Other ways we've seen it done, certainly the Department of Defense for Energy, huge user of energy. Energy that comes with insurmountable costs, right, that very, very difficult to think about how do you manage that. So they have a mandate to look at alternative energy sources that allow them to be much more energy sufficient. There, it's a matter of testbed sites. So we have projects that are out there testbedding on bases in the southeast right now, air conditioning systems, to stay with my prior example, where those are going to be able to demonstrate what's going on. Each of the services has said they're going to put up a gigawatt of power to renewables in the next by 2020. Some of them are as soon as 2015. And so you have 3 gigawatts of renewables going to be committed to by the military. So they're creating a market, again, to a value by an end user that the technologies can go and fill. So I think there's a number of ways separate from the policy piece itself, which is difficult right now, to say how do you move technologies forward through these various stages.
Adam?
Just to add to that, I think, historically speaking, you're either asking for policies that break open existing infrastructures. I don't remember who it was that said, competition is great, but a monopoly is even better. And consequently, the advantages that come from that mean that to crack open the infrastructure and create a market for a new technology, and you can take the breakup of Ma Bell as an example to suddenly come up with all the new technologies we have today for telephone and data transmission, as an example, or one that's dear to our hearts, which is the renewable fuel standard, which has cracked open a space for biofuel providers to get in there and see if they can do it. And it's been pretty darn successful, independent of your views about the sources, to the point where it's a threat, So either you're asking for, and I think market-based policies are good ones to ask for. We have great solutions. Give us a spot in this marketplace to let us prove it. I think those kinds of policies are good ones and historically in the United States have been successful.
I'm going to give a very different perspective, having spent most of my career in the academy. I think the chemistry departments are largely the teachers of pre-med students. I believe I've seen statistics that only about 1% of the general chemistry students want to become professional chemists. Even the chemistry majors, a large percentage of them want to be pre-meds. And so our curriculum has really focused on teaching to the med school admissions test. And the and much of our curriculum, and even in general chemistry, is physics light. It's very reductionist. What we don't have in the chemistry curriculum is breadth, systems-based thinking, holistic thinking. And that's what green chemistry is all about, is seeing how every piece fits together. And so there is a real challenge here for the academy to try to bring back that kind of qualitative breadth and systems-based thinking into the curriculum and still allow our students to be competitive for admission to medical school.
Thank you. We have a question from the United Kingdom. Dr. Sheldon.
Oh, maybe it's family. Question from the United Kingdom. What are the most significant developments in green chemistry over the last two decades? And where do you think the most significant developments will be in the next 10 years?
Oh, we can just start with whomever.
I'm not sure I should answer that.
Or audience
I'll
participation.
Leave that to one of these two guys.
Cheryl?
I mean, I think there's been tremendous advances in what we've seen from moving from a technology that people weren't sure if it was going to work to it was working and it was expensive to it's actually coming down where it's cost parity with oil produced in the whole bioplastics, bioadipic acid, right? We're getting there in a lot of these specialty chemical areas. I think that's pretty significant. I think if I look 10 years ago when some of the research was first coming out, was this really ever going to work? Were we really going to be able to compete at scale with large volume plastics? And we're not there in every area, and it certainly still has challenges, but I think the development there is very significant. I think our ability to move the biofuels processing generally forward as a system has advanced very significantly in an industry that doesn't move very fast historically. And so looking forward, you know, I don't even know how to think about it because I think we're reaching a tipping point in people's thinking, which means that 10 years from now it will be, you know, this massive difference from today. I'm very hopeful that some of the areas like we're funding today, you know, electrofuels and petro and those projects, we were really changing so you can move away from the energy water nexus. That's a very troubling place for me because we haven't crack that nut. I think getting away from that, and there's a lot of answers coming from a lot of different parts of the industry. I think our ability to, I do think our ability to manage energy efficiency is going to step change. I think the combination, again, devices, systems, to your point, Matt, of, you know, the whole idea of physics, chemistry, all of these things coming together to think about whole systems is going to be massive.
I'll make a prediction that, you know, the next crisis the world's going to have to face is water. And desalinizing water is very expensive in terms of energy. I think that's, and 90% of the water we use in this country is used for agriculture, so it's tied into food. So food, water, energy, this is the nexus, as Cheryl said. And I think if you want to start with a grand challenge, I think it's desalinizing water in a way that is not very energy intensive.
Adam?
Yeah, and I think as we realize that we're not getting out of carbon being part of our lives, in that the mine of carbon is not under the ground, it's in the atmosphere. Learning how to capture the carbon that's in the atmosphere, whether you're doing it via a plant and then converting the plant into every other form of chemical we need, or you're doing it through really novel techniques that Cheryl mentioned. I think that's where our huge opportunity is for green chemistry. We're not getting out of the need for carbon, and we're going to have to get it from the atmosphere eventually.
Thank you. We'll take this question. This gentleman's been very patient.
Hi, Jared Grossman. I'm a graduate student at Syracuse University. I just had a question about, do any of you have any recommendations for raising green chemistry awareness to perhaps other students and faculty that aren't familiar with it, especially talking about a pre-med curriculum that is common in many colleges?
I think we should all send them to the rock concert that nobody's going to be at. I think that would be the most compelling way.
I don't have an easy answer to that one, and I spend a lot of time thinking about it. There's a lot of inertia in the university. Please realize that most of our infrastructure for teaching chemistry and other sciences is Sputnik era. The taxpayer is not really in a mood or have the means to ante up huge capital projects to create the new infrastructure to teach this way. You have crusty old scientists like me who are invested in a different area. So the challenges are there. I think administrators get it and students get it, and I think it's all about hiring young people like you who get it and having them define the new culture.
I'll add to that. I serve as an advisor to my home state university in the engineering program about this thing, and I think one of the smartest things you can do, and you can help to drive this, is to ask companies that are in this space to come in and talk to students. Because I know from talking to the professors that, you know, there are opportunities there for them in everything from grant and research work to placing students in companies. But get these companies to come in and talk. And the students can do a little work there to find out who that is. And so everywhere you have those kind of forums occurring, push the envelope a little bit to ask some of those companies in the space to come in and talk.
Yeah, and I would just build on that a little further. I think, you know, what excites us and inspires us is something that drives for something that's bigger. So we can paint a picture of that bigger future. But the other thing that really defines us today is where are we going to be able to be employed? And I think to your point about the employers, if people are hiring to do these types of jobs, to the chemical engineers and the chemists and the biologists, for them to talk about what they're doing and why what they've been doing with green chemistry is really important for their businesses, that will be compelling as to why I want to go into this, I want to support it, I want to, you know, buy detergent even, right? There's this whole movement. But I do think that the hook of, yes, if there's hiring, there's opportunity in this space. I think, Matt, you put it up on your slide. That's where the opportunity will be in the future. And I think the sooner we can pull it into jobs for today and examples, everybody's going to figure out what part of this, what courses, what summer schools they're going to go to. And I think it feeds on itself.
And we have a very relevant question to that Dr. Sheldon will read from a participant in Thailand.
This is a question from Thailand. According to the 2011 Pike report, green chemistry is forecast to grow to approximately $100 billion in 2020. Do you agree or disagree with this forecast, and why?
Well, I certainly agree with that forecast, or maybe I just want to agree with that forecast. But, if you look out there in the space and the innovation that's going on today and the dilemmas that we've all been talking about, it's easily that figure, if you ask me. It's going to be much bigger than that. Who knows about the timing exactly? We've got this little issue about the global economy right now. But at some point, that is going to happen, and I think it's bigger than $100 billion.
No other takers for that one, but very relevant. Dr. Sheldon, you also had a question you wanted to ask, and then we'll go back to the mics here.
I have my own question, and that is, and it has something to do with what other people have already asked as well, and that is, a lot of the good ideas and the new innovations, they come from entrepreneurs who have their own small companies. And To advance green chemistry, you need good research. And good research can be done in academia, but it can be done in large companies. And they generally can get their funding one way or another. For small companies, it's not always easy, and only if you can attract venture capitalists. And how can we ensure that taxpayers' money gets to these good ideas and innovations in small companies, SMEs, small and medium enterprises? How can we ensure that?
You thinking about Solyndra?
I'm not thinking about any... I'm not thinking about that company, no.
Well, there are some people who think the government should not be picking winners and losers in the private sector. But for the NSF, the answer to your question is the innovation core. If scientists discover something in their lab, they can apply for funding through the innovation core to receive the training they need along with their student to write a business plan and to attract capital.
And I would like to add that Michael Leffenfeld, who's one of the co-chairs of this conference, is involved with the American Chemical Society Entrepreneurship Initiative, which is really a parallel process to do very much the same thing, training and resources for entrepreneurs to help grow their businesses to the point where they can attract the kind of capital that they need. We have another question over here.
Rich Engler, EPA, I sort of wanted to respond, to add to what you said about changing people's attitudes about green chemistry and something. I mean, I've spent a lot of years trying to educate people about it, and something I've found successful, sort of I've changed strategies. When I talk to scientists, tell me about your research, hey, you know, that aspect of it is green chemistry. So show them what they're already doing is green chemistry. And then that really opens their mind to, hey, I'm already doing this. Maybe I can do a little bit more. So you don't have to completely change what they're doing. You just have to raise their awareness about what they're already doing.
Thank you. That's a great comment. Next question over here.
Yes. Marty Mulvihill, UC Berkeley. I have a question about looking at another aspect of green chemistry. So I think we've really talked a lot about the efficiency, the water, energy, food nexus. I think these are big drivers, especially in chemistry departments. I know they are at UC Berkeley. But when I look across campus at some of the other people who are excited about green chemistry, they're really excited about the opportunity for safer materials, to move away from things like endocrine disruptors, to move away from environmental pollutants. And I know this is harder for the chemist to think about sometimes because we lack some of the proper training. I'm wondering from your perspectives, both in industry and government and as funders, what do you look for as convincing metrics to show that material solutions to these energy and food and water problems actually will be made with safer materials? So how do you think about that, the other half of green chemistry, so to speak?
Well, I'll mention again that the National Science Foundation has two merit review criteria, intellectual merit and broader impacts. We don't specify how to metricize broader impacts, but reviewers typically look for productivity. In terms of scientific papers, they typically look for number of students matriculated, and they tend to look for the impact of those publications as well. So we don't micromanage the broader impacts to the level that you may be referring to.
Any other thoughts from the panelists?
No, I mean, I would agree. I think that we set up our metrics for the ultimate outcome in energy, and we would certainly, as we evaluate proposals, have elements like that, if they're obvious in a proposal, come up, because, again, this broader impact would certainly differentiate. But given the breadth of what we're looking to fund, I think we'd be constraining if we tried to put it in as an upfront versus keeping it as a broader impact look as well.
Yeah, this may be a different twist on this, but I think just the promotion of green chemistry alone by default helps with safer materials. And the reason I say that is if we take our example, when you incorporate nature-based systems, you're in many cases eliminating hazardous materials or these kind of things. Or if you're working on biodegradability of a material, it's going to be a safer material, if you will. So I think it's maybe a hard question to answer because in my world, it's almost by default in a way. But I do think as we work with green chemistry, we will either be reducing the amount of more hazardous materials and or we'll be uncovering ways to make similar materials with similar properties but are of either safer in their production or safer in their use.
Thank you. This is sort of late-breaking news that I think everybody will be interested in. We have about 200 people sitting in this room, and in addition, we have 238 registrants from four continents and 32 countries listening in and participating, including Argentina, Brazil, Egypt, India, Nigeria, Russia, and South Korea. So I think we have to say that this meeting has been a very big success, and we have a couple more questions. But I want to remind our international listeners, gcehybrid@acs.org. We'll take a question from Dr. Peoples.
Thank you to the panelists. You've got some real insights going here. My question, think of this question in the context of the global audience that we are now hearing from, that the solutions that work in San Francisco may be different from the solutions in Shanghai versus in London, and the context of silos. And I'd like to ask each of you to reflect upon what it is from your particular perspectives we can do to facilitate interdisciplinary approaches to tackling these very complex challenges facing society in the 21st century. But in particular, we're scientifically trained and we tend to think about scientific disciplines. That's the hard sciences. And I think there's another dimension here that we should talk about regarding the social sciences and the important role they can play in tackling and bringing, you know, novel thinking and solutions to bear on these problems.
I can take a first shot at that because it's, you know, we have 5,000 employees plus globally and over 1,500 scientists and engineers. And being one, I know one of the traps that we can fall into is, you know, who's the smartest and whose technology works and whose doesn't. And sometimes when you go to conferences, one of the things that drives me crazy is you've got a panel of guys all trying to provide a common solution in the same space, and yet if you were an audience member and didn't know much, when you walked out, you would think one was the best or they haven't really figured this out yet or these kind of things. So the point I'm trying to make is, whether it's within our own company or it's among companies, one of the things that we can certainly do is talk more in terms of what are all of the solutions we could bring to this and what are some of the best ones and these kind of things. And if we can find a way to create more of a mantra of it's not about what doesn't work, it's about all the things that could work. And in that spirit, then if we collect in the forums like we have here today, if we think more like that, then you get less of a silo effect. You get more system thinking, and it becomes less of a who's the smartest, who's got the best technology exercise, which confuses the public sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Cheryl?
So as we think about breaking down the silos, a number of ways. We're always out there going to different meetings. A lot of our program directors come from a particular discipline, electrical engineering, chemistry, chemical engineering. But as they enter a space, we're very much pushing them, and we have a group of fellows who do this as well, to be out there at other conferences and speaking to your point. Mm-hmm. This is the problems we're trying to solve. We think you have an angle to this. And opening up and not being afraid of having that group tell you, you're wrong, we don't play there, or whatever. But I think by opening up the conversation and going in, I mean, I always urge people at ACS meetings, if you want to network, don't go to the same sessions you've always gone to, because you already know all those people. So I think we could just expand it at the Philadelphia meeting first, before we get too far abroad. But the other thing that at ARPA-E we really emphasize is we're technology agnostic. So when I say that I want battery technology to fit this and this metric, in the case of our BDIP project, we have something like 8 different chemistries, again, all going after that same objective. And that is truly, we look at a portfolio of solutions because we don't know what's going to work or not. We don't know what some of the learnings from the different groups might build on each other, and we certainly encourage that. But I think both of those things really, really help to break down silos and remind people that they have answers that you haven't thought about yet.
Matt?
No, I think Cheryl said beautifully. We have that rule about solvent, like dissolves like. It's natural to cluster with people you know and see the world the way you do. But you're not going to grow if you do that. So.
We have a question over here, and then we have a question from China. So let's take the question here in the room, then we'll go to China.
Hello, Krishna from the Green Chemistry Foundation, India. I'm curious to know that, as in your individual experiences, what have been the key barriers or the roadblocks to come together as stakeholders, as government, as industry, and as funding agency to come together and collaborate? What have been the key barriers?
Well, from my perspective, green chemistry is relatively still a new and unproven part of academic chemistry departments. It hasn't fully established itself yet the way it needs to, so I think that's just a reflection of the long time constant. You know, faculty have long careers, and it's they don't turn over that rapidly. So I think there's really just not a critical mass of faculty in the United States mm-hmm. with these interests yet.
Barriers, when I say it's like collaborating with each other, you know, the academia collaborating with the industry and the industry collaborating with the government, that kind of barrier. I mean, in that perspective, what have been the key barriers in collaborations?
I mean, I think some of the key barriers are simply the language hasn't evolved, to your point about the time, right? Green chemistry means nothing. What am I supposed to do with it? Who do I call together to discuss it to drive outcome? I have to define it by I want to talk about green chemistry processing, or I want to talk about what the enzymes are going to do, right? You've got to, we don't have a common language yet. We don't have subsets of groups of people who come together. And so I think the barrier sometimes is who's going to be involved in the conversation? What am I trying to do? You have to get it down to the actionable level and then say, who's going to be the group of people that I need to help? I think if you find people, and again, only haven't been in government for 9 months, this might be naive, but if you find something that's, you know, if it's in the wheelhouse of the building technology group at DOE about building efficiency, and there's an academic group and a company that wants to talk about it, the convening power of government will show up and they'll bring other people together on that subject. I don't think that part's the problem. I think it's saying, what thing do we want to focus on? Where do we want to go with it? And so it's a little bit of a language issue over time, and I think it's starting to parse itself out better.
Yeah, the biggest barrier I run into, and I'll probably be running into this on the Hill this afternoon, is that there's a perception and a paradigm sometimes about just the word green. Green means, to some people, well, more expensive or something that's being imposed upon us, etc. What we know from decades of really good business is that green can actually be really good profit, good value, good money, okay? And the societal benefits are, of course, huge. So when we talk about it, the barriers are, in some ways, the word green. I know that sounds crazy in this room, but it's the truth. So when I go in and talk about green chemistry, I talk about the specific application and what it's done for a community, a customer, a business, and the value that it's created. And then, you know, if you want to stick a label on it and say, and you know, by the way, that's what we might call green chemistry inside our house, then it starts to get traction. So I think a big barrier is just still some societal paradigms about what green really means, not to mention just what does it mean within this room.
We have a very relevant question from China, Dr. Sheldon.
Before I say the question, I'd just like to add a comment to this, and that is the public perception of what green chemistry is probably a lot better than the perception in this room. Because if I am coming to a conference on green chemistry and somebody asked me in the airplane what I'm doing, I said, I'm going to a conference. They say, well, what's the conference on then? And I say, green chemistry, and it's always received very positively. If I just said, I'm going to a conference on chemistry, it would have received a very different reception. So the public perception of green chemistry is very positive. Which brings me to the question from China. The question from China is, how can we engage the public at large in making them aware of the value of green chemistry? Maybe that's a good question for Madeleine.
No, I'm going to turn this over to the panel. If they have no thoughts, I'll mention a few ideas. Cheryl?
I think we've talked about it in some of our other answers. I think engaging in how it impacts what matters to them, and which is why I do think it has to be different in different parts of the world, in different subparts of countries, based on what the needs are and what's valued at that point in time. And so I think you have to get, again, focused on what you mean, and so you can make it valuable to the people. Otherwise, I think it's like any influencing campaign, if it's too broad, it has no impact.
Adam, I think, did a good job of answering that question earlier, but why don't you go ahead, in case our listener came in late, about how you engage the
sure.
public at large.
And if you didn't hear it, I talked about a rock concert that we used to talk about what we do and the green effects of it. But I made a talk not too long ago about this very subject, and I think every company in here has the creative innovation inside your company to come up with creative ways to talk to the public about what you do and how it can affect the things that green chemistry is trying to address. I can give you a myriad of examples from Novozymes, but the latest one is, we have a biofuels car that has all kinds of stuff on the outside of it, and we have a NASCAR refueler who is famous, a guy named Chocolate Myers, and he loves that car so much he asked us to borrow the thing a couple of weeks ago, and he's driving around all over the country with this thing. But the point is, we came up with that just as, okay, how can we answer this very question? How can we make the public aware about these kinds of things? And every company in here can do that. If you just sit down and say, okay, what neat thing could we come up with? And I know some companies do, don't get me wrong. But sometimes it's not about a television advertisement or the way we normally would get our message out. Maybe sometimes it's a very different thing. And I know social media is a huge element of that to be utilized as a channel. But I challenge all of you innovators out here to use your innovation for engaging the public.
Matt?
Okay, well, again, I go back to my roots, my silo as an academician. I'm a faculty member at the Ohio State University, which is the largest university in the country. And half of the students who graduate from Ohio State have taken at least one course in chemistry. What is it that we would like? And of course, most of them are not going to be chemists. What is it that we want them to remember about chemistry for the rest of their lives? Is it quantum numbers? Or is it how chemicals are produced and how they're used and the benefits and the dangers to them? Maybe in the academy, we really need to ask ourselves the question, what chemistry do people need to know for life?
And Chemistry for Life is actually the motto of the American Chemical Society, mm-hmm. and our vision is improving people's lives through the transforming power of chemistry. So to answer Dr. Sheldon's question, every person in this room is really an ambassador for green chemistry, and it's not just talking to your colleagues, but it's talking to people in the grocery stores and in the shopping malls, and using teachable moments to talk about what it is to be, what green chemistry is. And there's lots of opportunities as you're walking along and people are talking actually in the grocery store about buying a particular product. I had an experience with a shopper actually in a grocery store where on Saturday mornings they give away free samples. And a gentleman was hawking a new cereal. And he was saying to a customer, and this cereal has no chemicals in it.
Yeah.
And I started to walk by, and I wheeled around, and I came back. I waited till the customer left, and then I gave that guy a piece of my mind. So, you know, don't lose that opportunity to try to educate people about whether it's, in fact, everything has chemicals in it. And by the way, there are actually many of them are very good for you. And here's what you really intended to say. If you want to talk about your product being organic and not containing man-made synthetic materials. But it's really important for everybody to take this on as a project because it can't be done just by one or two people. Now we have another question over here.
Hi, my name's Keith Wing. I'm an independent consultant in Wilmington, Delaware. I have a question for Cheryl and Matt. I'm quite curious to know when you have discourse with practitioners of large energy, let's say petro, natural gas, coal, companies like that, what's the level of receptivity or traction that your agencies have with these parties? I'm quite curious about it. I mean, we all see commercials on TV about programs that each of these companies have in renewable energy, but you know, when you come to talk with them, how does your message resonate?
Well, you know, for us, I think really well. You know, a couple of examples. So we have an MOU with Duke Energy, and Duke Energy's CEO has come out and said he views that his next plant will be renewable. It's renewables. It's efficiency, right? Because he's saying, I'm going to avoid putting that next plant in by investing in efficiency for my customers. So it's an avoidance, which, again, good in the big picture. They're very committed to move new technologies forward, and that's why they have an MOU with us. So that's a specific public example that I can cite about the commitment early on for energy technology with one of the utilities. We get reports and meetings all the time, debriefs from the various of the oil and gas companies. Where do they see things going? Obviously been very dynamic in the past several years. Gas, right, what's that mean? Questions about nuclear, what's going to be the mix of fuels? What's it mean for infrastructure? What's it mean for vehicles, right, as you start to parse this out? And so we get a lot of debriefs, but they're always very interested in where do we see things going and what would be transformative. Because, you know, I was on the stage with the guys from Duke Energy and EPRI in another panel, and we were talking about carbon capture and the fact that in parts of the world it's priced and parts of the world it's not. But he said, you know, we need to keep investing in this space because at some point people will realize that there's gases in other sources like nat gas that you're going to have to capture. Like, he was trying to expand this view of this isn't just carbon capture because of coal. This is technology that's going to have a lot of applications, and as part of the industry, they recognize these things. And so, again, how much investment each of them doing is per their own business strategy, but I've seen across the board a broad interest because they recognize the dynamism in this space.
Any other panelists here? Matt?
My involvement with leaders of industry usually is confined to events like this, to other symposia, to other workshops, and I have found it to be very useful to learn what the key scientific questions are that need to be solved sometimes and where the key competencies are in the students that students need to have to be employable. And so in some way I can't quantify that sometimes shapes our programs.
Okay, we have now three questions left, which is exactly the amount of time that we've got. So I'm going to start here, then we're going to have a question from a listener in Bulgaria, and we'll end over here.
Thank you. A question for the panel. I'm Richard Wool from the University of Delaware, and we've been very impressed this week by the magnitude and the economic opportunity associated with this approximately $1 trillion business in materials from renewable resources. But there's one of the grand intellectual challenges for the future is how do you handle the three legs of the stool, the green engineering, the green chemistry, and the toxicity issues, and the latter probably belong in NIH. How do we structurally address green chemistry who really don't understand the properties, and the green engineers who don't understand the chemistry or the toxicity necessarily, and the toxicity people who understand neither the properties typically or the basic chemistry or the economics? How do we structurally handle those three intellectual elements of the stools of bio-based materials to go forward in a manageable way? From NSF, perhaps.
Okay. Toxicity in some ways is still an immature science. It is difficult. All of us in this room could look at a small molecule and predict something about its solubility, its boiling point, its melting point, right, its color. It's very difficult to look at a molecule de novo and predict its toxicity. That's a grand research challenge in chemistry and the kind of thing that we would fund research in that area to allow the development of chemical principles to be predictive of toxicity. Another challenge is that toxicity literature is very fragmented. It's in many places. So we need to come up with ways to mine the data and to pull it all together in a user-friendly way. And that's another kind of exercise that NSF would be interested in funding.
As a chemist, can you look at a molecule and write down its properties?
I can guess pretty well whether it'll dissolve in water or gasoline or whether it would boil at a certain temperature range or how it would react with water in a way. And I can do that much more easily than I can predict what organ of the body it might accumulate and what chemistry it might do there.
I think this will be a great conversation to continue over lunch. Let's take our question from Bulgaria and then our final question, and we'll wrap it up. Dr. Sheldon.
Okay, the question from Bulgaria is, do it as nature does can expand the value proposition of green chemistry. How do you project nature's parallel in future endeavors?
Do you want to interpret that question, especially the second part? I had a little trouble with that one myself.
Yeah, well, it's not easy for me either. It's a question of definitions, and it's like when I was recently at a reception and a lady asked me what I did, and I said I'm an organic chemist. And she said, well, that's not possible. She said, you've got organic vegetables and you've got organic fruits, but organic chemists is just not possible. And that is sort of, that is a bit the nature, do it as nature does. What we're talking about here is everything that is natural green? And I would say, well, not necessarily. And not everything that is natural is non-toxic, and everything that's synthetic is toxic. So we've got a problem here with definitions.
I don't know if it would help. I guess one way that I think we talked about earlier, the idea of, for the future, as we bring together people to rethink things, if we're rethinking how do we construct a process to manufacture something? Again, we've always viewed bigger is better, it's going to be more efficient, we'll be able to manage things. I think if we do go back to how does nature process certain things, what are some pathways that happen, do they require water, do they happen in other media, to kind of rethink what we've used historically, I think that way we could use other things that nature does in a system sense to think about how we can challenge the way we normally do things. So I don't know if that helps the questioner, but that would be one thought I'd have about that space.
Thank you. We'll go to the last.
I'd like to add to that, because I think that is hitting the point, yeah. Barry Commoner once said, in nature there is no waste. Everything is recycled. Mm. And I think that is at the bottom of this question as well, that nature does it without making waste. Mm-hmm. And so that's green.
And here's our last question.
Hong, and I'm an undergraduate at Yale University. I wanted to ask the panelists if you had any thoughts and advice for students who are just starting out and have not yet decided whether they want to work in industry or academia.
Industrial chemists outnumber Matt on the panel, so.
Is it a question, should you pursue academia?
Or policy, just students who haven't yet decided what they want to do but have an interest in green chemistry, if you had advice or any other thoughts.
Obviously, I have a bias there. But I think the very exciting things that are happening in companies today are going to change the game. And the reason I pick that is because, look, the more commercial examples we have, the more the public can see it as reality, the faster I think we'll get the adoption and understanding and promotion and policies that support green chemistry. So there is a shortage of brain power out there today in industry. And so we want as many of you guys as we can get to help get these solutions out there. I think sometimes it's difficult, and I know it is, I'll be doing that this afternoon, to talk about policy needs when you don't have as many good commercial examples in your pocket, especially when you're talking about an incumbent that you're competing with. So that's just my biased angle on it, but I do think it's the companies in this room that are going to make the difference as to society's understanding and adoption of what we're doing.
I'm going to urge you to come to the American Chemical Society National Meeting in Philadelphia and attend some of our career workshops that help expose you to the different careers and give you the opportunities to talk to people who work in academia, industry, government, consulting, entrepreneurship. There really are so many different possibilities. So I also would urge you to come to our website and take a look on ACS Careers at some of the information and workshops that you can kind of expose yourself to. But there's nothing like meeting people who work in the various places and finding out what they do and learning what they like and don't like about their jobs. So thank you very much. And I want to thank our audience listening from around the world, four continents, 32 countries, all over the world. The people in this room who have been incredibly patient, I really want to thank our very wonderful, clear, provocative panelists, Dr. Cheryl Martin, Mr. Adam Monroe, and Dr. Matthew Platz. And, of course, Dr. Sheldon, Roger Sheldon, Bob Peoples, and Michael Leffenfeld for organizing this conference. We have a lot of very exciting things left in this conference. First of all is lunch, which is, for those of you who are not in the United States right now, it's probably going to sleep. But for those of us who are here, you're going to get a lunch break at 1 o'clock. You do have a very exciting keynote speaker and sessions this afternoon. And I think that this has been a huge success. We're going to be sending everybody a questionnaire. We hope and urge you to fill out this questionnaire because, as by my count, my mathematics, we had almost 500 people from here and around the world engaging in this very, very important and provocative topic. So I think we're going to try and do more of these, but we want to hear from you about what went well from your viewpoint, what we could do better, and whether you'd like to see this kind of thing continue. This is really a historic first conference where we've been able to do this, and I'm very excited. So again, thank you very much for being here. I think, Bob, am I able to just close out this session? Dr. Sheldon, thank you very much, and lunch is served on your own.